and thank you. Welcome.
Welcome, Facebook. Welcome, YouTube. We're here. I'm already melted, but I'm not wrapped in polyester. It's all good. So we will start. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. What is our church's mission? To embody God's powerful love,
welcoming all people
with a vision and a message of hope, leading deep relationships, Jesus and humanity, and each other, and working, praising, and playing our talents in the world.
Please join me in the call to worship. We gather together in your presence and your expectation. Open our eyes and ears to the presence of the Holy Spirit.
May the seeds of your words scattered among us this morning fall on fertile soil.
May they take root in our hearts and our lives and produce an abundant
harvest of good works and deeds.
Amen.
And the gospel reading is from Matthew 1 through 9 and 18 through 23. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on a path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. If you have ears, hear. Hear, then, the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. That is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble and persecution arises on the account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of this age and the lure of wealth choke out the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God of all, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, the passage from Matthew today is called the parable of the sower, or the four soils, or the miraculous yields. But it reminds me of the story, three little pigs. I need my pigs up there. Yeah, my pigs. So, there's a book, it's really worth reading. It's a children's book, but it's really funny. The Three Little Pigs from the Wolf's Side of Things. It's hysterical. But anyway, we won't go down that rabbit hole. I promise. But, and we all know from that story how we should build our house, our faith, out of bricks, rocks. So that it doesn't get destroyed and wiped away by the big bad wolf, the evil that is out there lurking. And likewise, we should plant seeds, our faith, in rich soil so that we can be open and close to God, and also so that we can grow. There's lots of ways to look at this parable. Now, Ron and I, we both grew up in the Midwest. In the Midwest, there is black dirt. Make no mistake, it's black. Very rich for growing crops. And years ago, I was with some college friends as we drove from Syracuse to Milwaukee. Friends of ours, they got married in Milwaukee. Now, Artie, a really good Brooklyn boy, I don't think he ever had been out of the city except to come up to Syracuse for college. We get the far side of Indiana, and he asked the toll booth, in all seriousness, do you have anything here besides cornfields? Because that's all you saw on that interstate going across. Not unreasonable from his perspective. And I found it interesting that this year, the synod, which just had happened, is in Indianapolis. More cornfields, believe me. They got their Hoosiers out there. And then I moved to eastern Pennsylvania, and there's lots of red rock and soil. And then I came to Vermont by way of Jersey, and Vermont is very different. My front yard is good for growing ants. They got ant mills, ant hills, all over the place. My backyard has 6 inches of topsoil on top, and then you dig down, sand forever. And the lower end of Lake Champlain is all clay on the bottom. And there's a lot of slate. And so people from Jersey came up, bought land on Lake Champlain next to my in-law's little cottage. And he cut down a huge amount of trees on this hill going into the lake. He's going to build something. Well, all he did is park a camper down there. But he went against all the advice from the locals, who clearly knew better. Well, a few years later, everything went ew. And we go out, and the porch was now like 8 feet in the air. It had been like 1 foot, because the hillside slid. Everybody told him, he knew better. And never mind, Vermont's interesting topography that sets up streams and rivers for flooding as they cut through the mountains. Weather is very localized in Vermont. And once again, we got hit with large amounts of rain that kept coming and coming and coming, wreaking havoc in our communities. And after the first round of the flood, I went upstairs, and we had 3 inches of water in our little wastebasket. That's from the 2 holes in the ceiling that have a leak that are next to 4 feet of a previous leak. Something else that we really can't let alone, water seep into the building. That's been left there for years. We're just really lucky. We need to address that. So why am I spending all this time talking about dirt? And why was it such a deal that Jesus also talked about it in the form of a parable? So let's try and unpack this a little today. This has got to come off, folks. So God is the sower. He sows the seeds. And the sower is also Jesus, the disciples, anybody that teaches, preaches, talks about the good news, lives spiritually from that perspective. So in other words, we're all sowers of the faith. But God sows just like they did in Jesus' time, the wide scatter method. And actually, it can work, but that's not how we plant and grow today. So the seed is that message of the good news of Jesus and the kingdom of heaven that is available to us then and now, right now. Now, I hate to tell you guys, but we're all the dirt. But we're Vermonters, so we can be dirt, right? And talk of farming without offending anybody. I had to give Orion that we don't call things manure up here. We have a quicker, shorter name for that. But anyway, so what kind of dirt are we? What kind of question is that, Karen? Like, really? But the quality of our dirt, our self, our inner being, our soul, our heart, our mind, all makes a difference to what happens to us when that seed of the good news hits us. What does it mean to say that we're fertile, rich soil? How do we assess the quality of our soil? Am I getting a little sandy, rocky, gritty? I don't know. And what do we need to have that seed take hold, grow, and bring about a miraculous yield that only God can give? As we heard from this parable today, that God can do for us. How do we know when we're being really fertile and we're improving? And lastly, how do we nurture and feed good soil in each other? Why is God sowing the word among us in the first place? If you're not sure, go back to the beginning. God wants the best for each of us. God wants us to be, he really does. God wants to be in full body, mind, heart, soul, covenantal relationship with us, all of us. God wants the whole of creation to be bound together in love, to experience love that is abundant, fulfilling, and sustaining. God wants each of us to participate in the kingdom of heaven right now as we go about our lives bringing that word to others. that they too may be filled and experience the kingdom of heaven right now. This is possible because, remember, the kingdom of heaven is not some place you go after you die. The kingdom of heaven right now is a state of mind. It's not a place. It's a way of being, a way of living, a way of experiencing. I'm really dripping up here. Jesus died and was resurrected so that this could happen, folks. He talked constantly about the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And if he were here today, he would say the same darn thing. We can make it happen. It's happening now. And it's up to each of us to help this come about in our lives and to let others know about this too. We need to be opening to hearing the good news ourselves, fully hearing it, before we can go about sharing it with each others. And in the gospel passage for today, Matthew in verse 9 states, "Let anyone with ears listen." That's weird. But Jesus is exhorting us not just to physically hear, and believe me, hearing aids help, but they're not the same thing at all. To not just physically hear what he's saying, but to take it into your heart. Discern the message, ponder on it, think about it. Fully understand it so we can experience it. It's just until you really experience it, you don't get it. And if you don't get it, you can't go out and talk about it and act on it. And that experience, my guess is everybody is here has had many, many times, and we can have them many, many times more. And it's that experience that implants the message of God in our soul. We're to use our spiritual ears to do so. In other words, we're to listen deeply, listen with compassion, listen with the intention to open our heart to the word and to act on what we're called to do by God with what we hear. Amen. We become rich with understanding and a connection to the word and to God as a result of this spiritual listening. We become fertile, a conduit to the Holy Spirit that works in and through us. It also takes humility, because we need to set aside our egos, our earthly and physical desires, so that we can focus on what God is telling us and what God wants us to become and to do. We're always growing, folks. At least that's what God wants from us. And sometimes it's really hard to set aside the distractions, the negativity, the emotionality, the inward and selfish focus. Oh, and that old need to be in control. The need to know with full knowledge and understanding before I move forward one step. But we have to give this up to God to hold for us. We need to be open to the mystery of God working in our lives. That's what we can't understand. It's a mystery. We're not supposed to understand it. People write tons of books trying to understand it. And when we're really open to that mystery, God is leading us, but he leads us to unknown and unseen places. We may need to wait and prepare ourselves to be ready to have some of those things revealed to us. We have to set aside our fears, our anxieties, because that just shuts us down. No room for God, love, when we're afraid. Just plain and simple. And we really, part of humility is really giving God first priority in our lives. He has to come first. And we need to, it is really helpful if we develop a spiritual discipline to do these things on a regular basis to increase our receptivity to God's. I'd put a lot of stuff on the shelf really easy. Yeah, I'm going to do that. And we also have to put aside the idea that this is a solo venture we're on. It doesn't work that way. We're never going to be able to deeply listen if we do it alone. We need the support of others who are struggling with the same thing of how to become closer to God, to become more spiritual in our lives, to live as God wants us to live in relation to others and to the Trinity. This really sums up the purpose of our Sangha circle. And I think I can go on a limb and speak for the six of us. We need each other to do this work. And everybody here is doing this work. You guys really are. And you're each other's supports. I cannot stress that enough. Spiritual growth, to me, is the foundation of any growth of people, growth of mission, growth of finances, anything else. It's spiritual growth, folks. That has to come first. So thinking about all this, this could be part of our visioning process as the church. We set up a committee to guide and to lead us to come up with what our vision purpose is as the first congregational of Fairhaven in today's world, today, right now. So based on God's purpose for us and the message from Jesus that we read today, how do we go about spreading the seed so that it will grow in others as they hear it? Our mission statement needs to be a statement of exactly how we will do that in the next few years. We need to review and edit our current mission statement to fit that vision that we will come up with, which is tied to God's purpose for us. And if we take the gospel lesson for today, we're being called to first enrich our lives and then take that good news to the people in ways that takes into account where they're at and what they're capable of hearing in the moment. We can sow the seed generously and abundantly as God and Jesus did, and we are doing too. We may not know what will happen after we sow that seed. We may want to follow up with people, check on them. How are they doing? Have they grown any? We will want to give encouragement to each other and to others that we sow the seed to. Help them identify their own stumbling blocks to hearing the good news. Help them address the things that are hard for them to hear so that they too can grow and grow closer to God. We all have to acknowledge that we can help to change what we can change and what we cannot change. The old serenity prayer. And part of what we couldn't change this last week was the 1,000-year storm that came to Vermont. And on a Tuesday Vermont clergy call, it was really very moving because each of us checked in around the state of the status of our church, our communities, and the need. All I had to report was 3 inches in a bucket, not too far away. It was really damaged. And when the state was settled, people built along the rivers. It's the only way through the mountains. Easiest way to navigate those mountains. And we know the saying, there's no direct way to get there from here in Vermont. You don't go east to west very easily. And this afternoon, I thought I was driving down and going to take the ferry across the Long Island Sound and visit my friends for a week. Well, can't get to Bridport from here by going through Vermont. So I'm going to drive all the way around through the city to Long Island. done it before. I don't mind that kind of driving, but it was amazing when I pulled up the 511 map. There's these yellow triangles with an exclamation point. It was like, where's the green? There's all these yellow triangles. It was just, it's crazy. It's crazy out there, folks. We are lucky and we're blessed. So in St. Johnsbury, as in so many towns, the church, the parsonage, the mansions came along later as people accumulated money and they built up on the hill. And the low part of the river remained for the poor people. And often the stores were down there too. So the rain came, everybody got rained on, but not everybody suffered the same. And this is some of the stuff we can't control, but we have to live with. How do we make the kingdom of God in the midst of this suffering and these consequences? Because not everybody suffered the same. And in those, along the river, lots of the poor sections of town, lots of renters, who knows what the insurance that the landlord had? They may not have any. So we can't control a lot of the things that come our way. And we need to be reminded that the poor and the marginalized very often bear the brunt for the rest of us on their shoulders. And I'm almost done reading a book by Matthew Desmond called Poverty, by America. Woo, very enlightening. We're one of the richest nations, if not the richest, but not only do we have one of the highest rates of maternal death, but we have an economy or society that is really growing more diverse, more polarized. And our situation of poverty is very, very entrenched, despite years and years of throw this program at it, put money here, put money here. And people in this country don't have enough to eat, are existing below the poverty line, and the poorest of our poor are no better off than third world countries around the world. Yet we can't figure it out. Why am I bringing up these statistics now, and what does it have to do with us bringing good news to others so that they may be enriched? It's to point out that we don't all start at anywhere near the same level. Some of it's nature. The rain didn't rain the same place. And if you're at the bottom of the mountain, you're going to get a lot more water than at the top of the mountain. Some of it is the structure of our society and some of the attitudes that have come along with it. And we do need to take that into consideration, because for many people, our society is just stacked against them, pure and simple. And I would just really encourage anybody to read this book. It's fascinating. And it's not because people don't want to get better. They often have so much stacked against them, they can't. People want to live a fuller life. Do you think people want to live in the worst situation? Do you think people want to live on the streets in a tent? People don't want to do that. And they often don't have those same opportunities that many of us did. And it isn't just an easy racial thing either. That's part of it, a big part of it. But this is where we can take a stance against the social injustice of our society. This is part of the message from Matthew today, not just to be rich soil, but to act on that word, act on that seed that's planted in our hearts. Jesus was all about social justice for the marginalized, for the poor. He knew what he was up against in his society. It's no different today, no different. And each day we just love everyone without judgment, without the inner voice telling ourselves that they should just go out, get a better job, get some training. They can pull themselves up by the bootstraps, except they can't. So remember, we haven't walked in their shoes. Listen to them. Just listen. understand them. Don't judge first. So remember to pass on that judgment thing and reach out with a hand, a smile, and affirm them. God loves each one of us. So remember, as Matthew said, for those that have ears, listen. Amen. Oh, God, we rejoice in you. Let us practice our spiritual listening to really hear and know and have an experience of connection whenever we meet anyone. And may each of us come away fulfilled from that experience where you are right in the middle of it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now pass the peace, the love, the blessings.